above all, she has published on later Plato, the Sophist and the Phileros, its IPS volume, and the Timaeus. Lately, she has been focusing on time and affectivity, in particular pleasure, and has been delved into the later Stoics for their purpose. Besides the theoretical character of her undertaking, she is very much attracted by the great and concrete contributions that, for instance, Marcus Aurelius' work might exert on the cure of the affective disorders. I introduce Georgia, the philos, pleasures of learning, pure pleasures.
Plato's agenda in the Phaedo is to prove that the soul is immortal and to draw the correct conclusions about how one should live and die. He does not strain this agenda by pursuing a contest between knowledge and pleasure, the adjudication of which would require additional analysis to define pleasure and an evaluation of different kinds of pleasure. Instead of offering a critique of pleasure by means of scientific rigor and an exhaustive dialectic, all or part of which is carried out in the Philebus, Plato is concerned with the detrimental consequences of the bodily pleasures on the soul. Bodily pleasures hinder the philosopher's undertaking of purification and are therefore deprecated. Against this background, pleasures of learning are mentioned in the Phaedo. It is 114b, 115a. Socrates refers to them most explicitly after narrating the long story about the afterlife, when he underlines that philosophers should purify their lives of bodily pleasures and study the pleasures of learning instead. This is not a slip of the pen. In his defense of the philosopher's undertaking as a study of dying, he did not say that all pleasures are bodily, nor that the philosopher's endeavors will be devoid of all possible affectivity, rendering the philosophers men or women of stone, but that the philosophers must detach themselves from the realm of the body and its pleasures, which, alas, go hand in hand with pains. To date, Platonic research has thrown up some fascinating debates about Plato's pleasures of learning and knowing. The predominant areas of interest have been the arguments for and against the discrepancy between the philosopher's life as the most pleasant life in Republic Book 9, and the intellectual pains that are or seem to be included in such a life, and the riddle of pure intellectual pleasures in Republic 9, and the reconstruction of its relation to another riddle of pure pleasures in the Philebus. The Phaedo has not attracted much attention in the discussion of these intellectual pleasures, though researchers have pointed out a clearer recognition of them in this dialogue, which hints at their distinctive role in the good life, and thereby goes beyond what is offered in the Gorgias, and points forward to the picture drawn in the Republic. What has been debated in the Phaedo above all is the evaluation of bodily pleasures, with a focus on the question, does Plato think that they're bad in themselves, or is it rather a particular attitude toward them that we should reproach? My question in this paper is whether Phaedo's pleasures of learning are pure. I mean, whether we should understand them as being pure, since Plato does not focus on their analysis, and Socrates never characterizes them as pure. This question is legitimate, for purification is the general framework in the Phaedo. And moreover, it is a question that, though to my knowledge it has not been asked, is very important for the development of Plato's critical project on pleasure, a project that goes hand in hand with a critique of different types of hedonism. For the pleasures of learning are characterized as pure in both the Republic and the Philebus. According to Plato's philosophical project on pleasure, as I reconstructed on the basis of the Republic and the Philebus, first, pure pleasure, speed of sensation, or of learning and knowing, are not cessations of pains. To be more precise, they are not cessations of their opposite pains. In both the Republic and the Philebus, they are introduced as a piece of evidence against all pleasures being cessations of pain. And second, pure pleasures of learning, with the aid of the more authoritative Philebus, are unmixed with pain in their nature, which means that necessarily they are not mixed with pain, not that they are not necessarily mixed with pain, but sometimes they are. That said, There might be pains occurring before and after pure pleasures of learning, even only if these pains are not a constitutive part of this pleasure's nature, which would be the case if the pleasures of learning were the cessation of their opposite precedent pains. There can be pain preceding pure pleasures of attaining knowledge, for example, due to aporia, or pain following pure pleasures of knowing when, for instance, we realize we need a piece of knowledge we had acquired, but we have forgotten it. But pleasures of learning will be pure if they are not cessations of the opposite pain. That is, if the respective pain is not like the pain felt when we feel hunger, which Socrates makes explicit in the Phaedrus. In the pure pleasure of learning, there is no hunger for the object of knowledge someone desires to acquire, and there is no pain of hunger occurring before, a pain that will be relieved, and whose relief will give rise to the opposite pleasure. If one is pained by aporia after having realized one's ignorance and eagerly wishes to acquire knowledge in order to get rid of this pain of being stuck in aporia, and therefore understands and experiences the pleasure of learning as a relief of the preceding pain, one is not taking pure pleasure in learning, pardon me, but impure. Moreover, any subordination of learning to utilitarian calculations would deprive one of the experience of the pure pleasure of learning. For example, if someone fervently wishes to expand her CV, and if being devoid of this expansion causes distress in her, and when attaining and applying knowledge she is relieved of this particular pain, this pleasure is not a pure pleasure, according to my reconstruction of Plato's sketch. My answer to the question I ask in this paper is yes, Phaedo's pleasures of learning are pure. Here I leave aside the question of whether the Phaedo's pleasures of learning are free of the body and its realm, a question that I also answer yes, and confine myself to answering my question by precisely delineating the purity as freedom from pain. In support of my view, I highlight the following. Namely, that the Phaedo's pleasures of learning are, in contrast to bodily pleasures, necessarily not preceded and necessarily not followed by pain, but necessarily free of pain. To do so, I will focus on the initial example of pleasure that Socrates introduces in the first section of the second part of the paper, and in the second section, I consider Socrates' autobiography throughout his philosophical adventures, and despite all the twists and turns, his joy of learning in its own nature has been free of pain. The philosopher's freedom has many aspects. Among others, the philosopher or the lover of learning breaks free of the natural and very often vicious circles of depletion and restoration. Nowhere in the Phaedo do we find an analysis or a model of bodily pleasure, but we do encounter a significant example of such a pleasure at the very beginning of the narrative. Socrates namely wonders at the phenomenon of what people call pleasure after he's released from his fetters. He says, "How strange does it seem to be that what people call a pleasant thing, my friends? How remarkable is its relation to what seems to be its opposite, namely what is painful? They are not willing to be present in us, the painful and the pleasant, both at the same time. But if one pursues one of them and grasps it, one is almost always compelled to grasp the other, too, like two creatures attached to a single head. It seems to me," he said, "that if Aesop had reflected upon it, he would have composed the fable that God wanted to change their enmity for friendship, but because he could not, he fastened their heads together. Because of this, when someone has one of them, then the other follows. This seems to be happening to me. After pain was caused in my limb due to the fetter, now pleasure seems to be following." I will focus on two questions that are relevant to my purposes. What it means that first, pleasure and pain are not willing to visit us simultaneously, and second, that they are inseparably connected. I think that in order to give the right answers to both questions, we need to understand Socrates as not referring to all kinds of pleasure, a clear indication that a general claim for pleasure for all pleasure is not being made, is that Socrates speaks of what people call pleasure. Instead, I take Socrates to be referring to a particular type of pleasure, including the pleasure he feels in his limbs after the release from the fetters, namely bodily pleasure. So as I see, the scope is not as broad as to include all pleasures, nor as narrow as to be restricted to nothing but the particular bodily pleasure that Socrates is experiencing in the present moment. To the first point and question. We have to consider the meaning of the assertion that pleasure and pain are not willing to be present in us, both at the same time. Plato cannot have his Socrates' meaning that any kind of pleasure and any kind of pain cannot coexist in a single subject, which would contradict our most common experiences. For it is possible that the same subject experiences pleasure and pain at the same time, as long as the pain is not the pain opposite to that pleasure. We can have an unfamiliar mixture, as Phaedo reports, 59a, on the one hand, pleasure due to doing philosophy, on the other hand, the emotional anticipatory pain due to the subsequent loss of a friend and teacher. But regarding opposite pleasures and pains, take for instance the pleasure of eating and pain of hunger, we can either be in the process of disintegration of the natural state in equilibrium and therefore feel pain, or be in the opposite process of restoration and feel pleasure. We cannot feel both pleasure and pain since we are in one process, feeling pain, or the other, feeling the opposite pleasure. Of course, things can be further complicated because it is the soul that feels pleasure related to bodily processes, and so we can have pain due to bodily disintegration and at the same time pleasure of anticipation of the opposite process. This combination, a subtlety that is not worked out in the Phaedo, is possible because we have a pleasure of the soul and a pain originating in the body, which can occur simultaneously. Based on what I concluded so far, let me turn to the second point in question and try to understand the inseparability of pleasure and pain here at stake. I would suggest a bit of caution in this undertaking. Socrates maintains that when one, not he himself, pursues a certain kind of pleasure, for admittedly no one will aim at pain, one will inevitably get the rest of the package, namely pain. Σχεδόντι αναγκάζεσται, i.e. λαμβάνει κατ' το χέτερο. I read nothing more and nothing less than this view in these lines, but what does this mean? From the nothing more, Socrates draws thereby no general conclusion that bodily pleasures and pains are experienced in continuous alternation. Pleasure necessarily following pain and pleasure bound to be followed by pain, which would contradict our experience of accumulation of episodes of pleasure or pain. Moreover, I would need some strong evidence in the Phaedo to support the view that pleasure follows pain to be followed by pleasure, and this is all, which would contradict the Republic and the Philebus, in both of which Socrates corrects the logical flow of those who believe that pleasure is a cessation of pain. They namely overlook the reality of the intermediate state that is neither pleasant nor painful, but depending on the comparison to the painful or the pleasant state, it sometimes appears to be pleasant and some other times painful. I find no evidence in the Phaedo that there is no intermediate state between pleasure and pain. In addition, Socrates does not admit that pleasure has followed pain in the particular example he brings up. On the contrary, he says that the release from the fetters appears to be pleasant, which hints at the question, is it really pleasant? As for the nothing less, the question becomes more pressing. What is the view then for the exemplification of which Socrates gives his example? Let me give it a try. There is some pleasure that is inseparably and in its own nature that is necessarily connected with pain. Thus, the necessity does not refer to the particular sequel, but to pleasure's inseparability from pain due to its own nature. Satisfying the need and experiencing the pleasure brings about the opposite, depletion, whose satisfaction reinstates the original depletion and reactivates, if not intensifies, the initial desire for satisfaction. Despite some intermediates of some fleeting moments of peace, war prevails. And under certain circumstances, we can even be caught in a vicious Sisyphean or incurable Callicleon circle. Therefore, we are chained not only to pain, as said above, but also to this predictable repetition of never completing and never ceasing circles of depletion and restoration. Only death do us part, or put it differently, completes, or rather puts a full stop to, this inevitably monotonous process. And the situation can become worse. False perspectives of pleasure can leave us unaware of where we are in the ongoing process, whether we are in pleasure or pain. We can now, I think, rightly situate the Socratic formulation that the release from the fetters appears to him to be pleasant. Let me turn to the next part. I will turn to Socrates, who, though not the single philosopher Plato portrays, paradigmatically exemplifies Plato's philosophers. that Socrates does not deprive his intellectual activity of affectivity, and in particular pleasure, is made clear throughout the entire dialogue. I will focus on a particular moment, on one moment in his autobiographical narrative. And I have a twofold motivation for this choice. First, instead of interpreting the passages in which the hedonistic calculus is conducted, in order to argue whether or not some openness is left for the philosopher's undertaking as being in a way hedonistic, I think we would do well to encounter directly the affective states and attitudes in Socrates' account. Second, no matter how we may interpret Plato's Socrates and his possession of knowledge or lack of it, Socrates portrays himself as he was when very young, at any rate in the process of learning and investigating the truth of physical accounts, and at this stage, he did not possess the knowledge he was after. Socrates was delighted to hear about Anaxagoras' book, for he thought that in Anaxagoras he had found a teacher from whom he would learn about intelligence as cause of all things, in accordance with his expectations. He thought someone should answer the question of what is the cause of what is, what comes into being and what perishes, by explaining why it is the best to be, to act upon or be acted upon this particular way. Socrates narrates in detail the aporias that he pleasantly expected Anaxagoras to solve, but adds, after getting hold of the books in all haste, I read them as quickly as I could in order to attain knowledge as quickly as possible of what is best and what is worst, and then, my friend, my marvelous hope was dashed. For Anaxagoras introduces but makes no use of intelligence as a cause, and to make matters worse, misunderstands material necessary conditions to be true and only causes. Socrates' hopes have been left unfulfilled, and he has not attained the knowledge he was craving. Before embarking on the second voyage, he says that he would be delighted to become the student of this kind of cause, a cause that he did not discover himself nor learn from anyone else. As I have reconstructed the pure pleasures of learning at the beginning, the previous presence of pain does not annihilate the pure pleasure of learning. So even if we think that Socrates is here registering intellectual pain, this does not mean that the pleasure of learning, which he will experience at least as dramatis persona when listening to the Timaean Physics, will be impure. For he does not say that he will experience the future pleasure as the cessation of the pain caused by them, as his hopes were dashed. Nonetheless, my claim is stronger than that. I believe that Socrates is not registering any intellectual pain at all in this moment. We should not read the pain into the lines, because we are in pain, we're not reaching the knowledge we have been craving for urgently and with eagerness. Instead of being distressed due to the puzzlement and confusion and because of the not yet attained knowledge, Socrates anticipates with great joy the future opportunity to become the student of anyone who can meet the challenge that the pre-Socratics could not, specifically to successfully expose theology in natural philosophy. He does not couple this pleasant anticipation with a present pain, the pain of being at a loss about the topic, the knowledge of which he lacks, and the lack is made explicit, he says, as the reason. Moreover, we should not read the pain into the lines, remembering the pleasures of anticipation of the Philebus, because these pleasures are pleasures confined to bodily processes of disintegration and restoration, and do not provide the model for anticipatory pleasures of attaining knowledge. Moreover, this is exactly the place where we would expect the philosopher to delve into his calculating business and compare pains and pleasures, for instance, the pains of the disappointment on the one hand, and anticipatory pleasure of future process on the other, but there is not a single trace of such a comparison either. Learning is pleasant to the philosopher, but not because he aims at pleasure or he subordinates learning and attaining knowledge to other goals like honor or money, but because learning is pleasant in its own nature. Given the above, what should we conclude about the pleasure of learning in the Phaedo? The Socratic narration makes clear that the path of genuine philosophical learning is never straightforward. What the Phaedo also specifies is that this path is necessarily free from pain, unlike bodily pleasure, which necessarily involves pain, as Socrates described it in 60 BC, and as it is very often, at least four times, coupled with pain in some passages. The philosopher's joy is much more strange than the phenomenon of bodily pleasure. This joy does not consist merely in the philosopher's freedom from the disturbances of the bodily pleasures and pains. It is called galene in 84A7. The Platonic intellectual pleasures accompany both the process of learning and the end of this process. The joy of learning in Socrates' narration is constantly present. It does not cease when the learning process comes to a certain end and the philosopher succeeds in securing some knowledge. Neither is it a kind of blessing that emerges only after the philosopher has attained knowledge and not in the process. Socrates' pleasure of learning unceasingly accompanies the philosopher throughout his philosophical journey, even when there is an impediment or a disappointment on his path. And I think it is deeply rooted in the real possibility of progress as it is realized in the history of philosophy, a progress that may not be fulfilled by this particular philosopher, Socrates in our case, but by those who follow him. Thank you.
I also think that intellectual pleasures in the theater are supposed to be read as pure pleasures. But there is one passage in the dialogue which disturbs me in this connection. It's 88 CD, when Phaedo says to Empedocles that after the Logos was defeated, we all, I quote, aedos, dietetemen, well, he says that there was this lack of togedu, aedos, because we all eis apistian katapeptoke. So I wondered if in this particular passage, Plato is applying the physiological model of pain or to the intellectual pleasure and pain. And I'm asking because in the Gorgias, you have this play of words, apistia is aplestia, and that is why those people who lived a licentious life in the netherworld, they are compared to these leak-proof vessels. So I wonder if this passage, well, you gave it a sort, or maybe these pleasures are not that pure after all, because there is this apistia, which is a lack of pistis, and which is considered to be painful in a way.
Thank you very much for this. Let me start by saying that the way I reconstructed the pure pleasures, the only thing I need to have a play, no, it's not the only thing I need. So pure pleasures of learning will be impure if, not if there is no pain beforehand. We can have pain beforehand. But if we understand the pleasure of learning to which we come afterwards as the cessation of this pain, as its opposite pain. The second point which you are in which I agree is that Plato has indeed the trouble with the model of bodily pleasures, and I think he reaches the way I read the Philebus, and this is based on how I read the Philebus, of course, is that he reaches his limits there. So it is a celebration, as Dorothea Freire says. He understands pleasure as a process of restoration, but at the same time, he understands that the intellectual pleasures cannot be based on this model, and Socrates makes it explicit that there is no hunger and no such a pain existing, preceding the pure pleasures of learning. So I would not take this passage as registering any pure intellectual pleasures, pleasure, because for this I need the pleasure to be the cessation of this pain, and not experienced for the sake of the learning itself. Does it make sense?
Yes.
Well, thank you. Sorry. Thank you very much for your paper. I like it very much. And because also it answers a question I always had when I'm trying to convince students, for example, what's the difference between doing philosophy and looking for other kind of pleasures. But because for Plato, philosophy in the Phaedo and also in other dialogues like the Phaedrus, it's always presented as an incomplete process. It's a process of learning, something that the attainment of knowledge, full, complete knowledge, you can never get it in this life. In the Phaedo, is many times underlined this, that you get knowledge as far as possible, you get to the ideas as close as possible, but you don't get there while you are embodied, your soul is embodied. And so this answers the question for me, why philosophy is the best way of life, why the philosophy otherwise would be suffering the same pain as the others if it wasn't because the pleasure of learning is pure, as you are trying to explain. So in that sense, I think it's a very good answer to that question, because otherwise philosophers would be suffering as much as any other man, because they would be suffering pain. But they are not, because they are always in the process of learning, and they are enjoying all the time in that respect. So that's I think is great. But I would like to know what you think about what it is said in book 5 of the Republic. When the philosopher is described, I don't have the passage in mind, I'm sorry. It is said that it has epitomia for knowing all the whole thing, not only to have opinions or separated beliefs. So I think that they are, we have a similar, you know, structure to the bodily pleasures and pains.
Yes,
I don't know if I was clear, but
yes, you were very clear. First of all, let's spread the good news for philosophy.
Yeah, exactly.
But be careful. True pleasure is a title, and whenever we think we have it, because we are learning, but it is we are happy to do this and that. Not learning for the sake of learning. It's not pure pleasure. Second. I am not that sure that I agree with you that there are no places in Plato where he says it is possible to have the whole in this life, or in the first part of the Parmenides, for example.
But in the field it is clear, because it's underlined as far as possible, as close as possible. There are many.
Yes. I am afraid, last point, I am afraid that lack is what characterizes all pleasures, according to Plato. And this is his limit. I mean, we celebrate that a philosopher reaches his limits and is aware of it, I think, in the Phaedrus. It is a double celebration.
Thank you. I have two last questions. And you put the question together, and after she...
Do you ascribe a desire for learning to Socrates or the philosophers in the Phaedo? I'm saying this because in the Phaedo was there the discussion of desire, and there, according to many interpretations, desire either involves or is pain.
The desire that is analyzed in the Phaedo is the desire regarding bodily
Yes, many interpreters think that it can expand to the case of the desire for love, but partly because of the wild way, just before the discussion, then losing our careers.
Yes, it is not a problem for me, the way I have reconstructed pure pleasure of learning, it is not at all a problem for me that there is preceding pain. Is this clear so far? Because if this is clear, then I would have no problem of someone experiencing aporia as painful before the pleasure of learning that would be pure nonetheless. Because it is not the cessation of this pain, the pleasure of learning. So this is the difference from the bodily model that might carry us away, I think.
Thank you very much.
Well, first, thank you very much for that presentation, which is very clear and convincing. I just have a very narrow textual question. And this is the passage at 60B, and in particular 60B, 7. What I want to ask you about is the schedule T, which really puzzles me, and you seem to be taking it differently. So again, what we would expect Socrates to say is, especially given the Aesop image of pleasure and pain being joined at the head, what we'd expect him to say is that whenever we take one, we are necessitated to always take the other. But he throws in his qualification, schedule D, anankasistai aeis. And so, and I've looked at done a quick search among the translators, and they seem to have no idea what to do with this. I mean, Casetano translates in certo modo, which I'm not really sure what that means, so in a certain way you're required to take the other. The Loeb I saw translates as generally, which means generally always we're required to take the other. And you've seen the paper, from what I understood, you used almost at one point. You're referring to that
always.
Almost always.
Yes,
which not means not always.
Not always.
So you do think
because we can have episodes of pleasure the one after the other, or episodes of pain the one after the other.
Well, that's
but what is in any case necessary is that we are caught up in a circle. Perhaps it's not, we cannot predict the exact way it will go because things can be complicated, very complicated indeed, as we know.
Mm-hmm.
The rest of the package will come.
So your reading then is what the qualification means suggests is that it might, if I have a certain pleasure, pain might not necessarily immediately follow
exactly.
It, but will follow it at some later
yes.
on in the.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Skip one paragraph and I'll edit another one. In Phaedo, Socrates argues that death is the separation of the soul from the body. The separation means deliverance from the limitations of the body. The resulting state of the soul approaches the divine. In this paper, I wish to explore one of the dimensions of this near-divine state, that is, deliverance from the pleasures of the body and their accompanying illusions. Socrates' account of the illusions associated with pleasure is made by way of two contrasts between the philosopher who is immune to these illusions and the non-philosopher who is not. The first kind of illusion is found in the descriptions of the soul of the philosopher and of the soul of the non-philosopher after both are separated from the body in death. The former soul, although joined to a body in life, maintains distance from it. When this soul goes away into death, to what is like itself, it is happy, delivered from wandering, ignorance, fears, and wild passions. By contrast, the soul of the non-philosopher leaves this life defiled and impure because it, quote, was always in the body and cared for it and loved it and was fascinated, goitetumene, by it and its pleasures and desires and pleasures, so that it thought nothing was true except the corporeal, which one can touch and see and drink and eat and employ in the pleasures of love. The second kind of illusion is found in another contrast between the soul of the philosopher and the soul of the non-philosopher, this time before death. The philosopher's soul undertakes the discipline of separation from pleasures, desires, pains, and fears. Thereby, it escapes the greatest evil. The soul of the non-philosopher does not escape from this evil. What is this evil? The soul of every man, whether it is greatly pleased or pained by anything, is compelled to believe that the object which causes the emotion is very distinct and very true, but it is not. These objects are mostly the visible ones, are they not? Now, there are two extended accounts of the illusions associated with pleasure, not in the Phaedo. One is in Republic 9 and the other is in Philebus. In this paper, I wish to use both to explore the illusions of pleasure in the Phaedo. I do not mean to maintain a thesis about the development of Plato's thought on the topic. I will rely on the softer assumption that the three assumptions are related, the three accounts, are related in such a way that they can be fruitfully compared. In fact, I will explore whether the account of the illusions of pleasure, the illusions caused by pleasure mixed with pain in Republic 9 and in the Philebus, can explain the illusions associated with pleasure in the Phaedo. Although both accounts are complex, I will select only portions of each. First, in the Republic, is the illusion that the absence of pain is pure pleasure. Second, in the Philebus, is the illusion that intense pleasure is pure pleasure. So, first of all, we'll talk about the account of the Republic. This account begins with Socrates recounting the way those who are sick say that nothing is sweeter than to be healthy. In general, people in severe pain say there is no greater pleasure than the cessation of suffering. There is also the opposite phenomenon, the cessation of pleasure is said to be painful. However, the cessation of pain, as well as the cessation of pleasure, is in reality a neutral state between pleasure and pain, called calm or hesychia. Socrates explains that pleasure and pain are motions. The neutral state is cessation of motion. So it is wrong to think that the cessation of pain is pleasure or the absence of enjoyment pain. However, he says the juxtaposition of calm with pain appears to be pleasant, and the juxtaposition of pleasure with calm appears painful. But there's nothing sound in these appearances with respect to the truth of pleasure. They are a kind of sorcery, guetaia. So stated, the illusion is puzzled. Pain gives way to the neutral state of calm, but what is really calm appears to be pleasure. It is just not that pleasure is actually absent from the episode. Rather, there is an explanation of the means by which the appearance of pleasure arises. There seems to be a missing step in the description. There is no answer to the question, why should the cessation of pain seem pleasurable and not just appear to be what it is, namely calm? In the face of this question, the appearance of pleasure seems gratuitous. There's good news here, though. The missing step is, according to me, added. In order to defeat the idea that pleasure by nature is preceded by pain, Socrates cites the pleasure of smell as an example of pleasure not preceded by pain. Nas says one should not think that pure pleasure is the cessation of pain. Up to this point, Socrates has been talking only about the appearance of pleasure. Now he's talking about pleasure as such. So we should conclude pleasure is not just the appearance of pain. Moreover, there is a belief that pleasure by nature is by nature preceded by pain, which is then shown to be false. If pure pleasure is not preceded by pain, then, since it is pleasure, pleasure is not by nature preceded by pain. At this point, however, Socrates concedes that what are called pleasures that stretch through the body to the soul, the most and the greatest, are a kind of release from pain. So even if pleasure is not just release from pain, there is a sense in which release from pain can be part of the most and of the greatest of bodily pleasures. We can explain this relation between these bodily pleasures and release from pain by starting with what we already know, namely that pleasures are motions. Later we learn that the motion is a kind of filling, while pain is a kind of emptying. Since pleasure is a process of filling and emptiness, and since emptiness is painful, these pleasures occur simultaneously with pain. And I expect George to jump on me about that. We find this simultaneous mixture of pleasure and pain in Gorgias. Thus, the bodily pleasure of filling exists side by side with the pain and emptiness. Then, at least in these cases, we can understand the reason that the cessation of pain appears to be pleasure. That is, one comes to think that the cessation of pain would leave pure pleasure, i.e., pleasure unmixed with pain. This result is confirmed by what Socrates has already said, namely, that it is wrong to think the cessation of pain is pure pleasure. However, why would he say pure pleasure instead of just pleasure? We can understand the reason if the mistaken belief is based on the assumption that once the pain of emptiness has ceased, pleasure alone remains. In effect, Socrates is denying what in other contexts is called the pleasure of satiety, the pleasure of being in a state of fulfillment. After all, if pleasure is just filling, once the filling is over, so is the pleasure. I'm now going to skip the next paragraph in which I argue for that interpretation I've just given using other texts in the Republic. And I'll turn now to the Philebus, to the second kind of illusion associated with pleasure. In the Philebus, Socrates explores a new theme of pleasure mixed with pain and its relation to illusions about pleasure. While Socrates recounts several different kinds of illusion, we will focus on only one. It depends upon the previously given in the dialogue, general account of pain as disruption and pleasure as restoration. However, Socrates adds a neutral state between disruption and restoration, a state of equilibrium that is neither pleasurable nor painful. To think that it is either is a mistake. At this point, one might expect, as in Republic 9, an argument to show how the mixture of pleasure and pain causes the neutral state to appear pleasurable. However, Socrates takes a different tack. The mixture can make pleasure seem intense and great, but this exaggerated appearance of the underlying pleasure is not pure or true pleasure, although some seem to think it is. Socrates focuses on the strongest and most intense pleasures in order to understand the nature of pleasure. These kinds of pleasures are preceded by the greatest desires. For instance, feverish patients suffer thirst and chill. Do they not feel greater deprivations and also greater pleasure at their replenishment? These pleasures are obviously mixed with pain, but their intensity and greatness is due to the strength of the contrast between the two. In these types of cases, the pleasure and pain can be equal, or one can outweigh the other. The ones of the greatest interest involve a surplus of pleasure over pain. Here, the predominant part of pleasure causes leaping and kicking, color changes, all sorts of distortions of features and violent palpitations in a kind of X-rated passage. Plato. By contrast, true pleasure is unmixed with pain. It is thus pure pleasure. Socrates gives several examples of bodily pleasures that are not associated with lack and pain, such as beautiful colors and forms, odors and sounds. Finally, he adds the pure pleasure of knowledge. So although the investigation of the nature of pleasure started with the greatest and most intense pleasures, these are not true pleasures. True pleasures are pure, unmixed with pain. Thus, the error this account exposes is thinking that intense pleasure is true pleasure. Without further analysis of this account of the mixture of pleasure and pain in the Republic, Nine, and the Philebus, we can see how it eliminates the notion of illusion associated with pleasure in the Phaedra. First of all, the dialogue begins with the theme of the mixture of pleasure and pain. Phaedo himself reflects on the unusual mixing together of pleasure and of pain that he felt in the company of Socrates on the day of his death. Then Socrates, as we've just reviewed, Socrates' appearance starts with his remarks about the way pleasure and pain are mixed as he rubs his legs where the shackles have just been removed. The reader of the dialogues cannot help but think of the account of mixed pleasures in Republic Nine and Philebus. In fact, if we return to the illusions associated with pleasure, we find the explicit textual links. First of all, is the theme of enchantment. When Socrates in the Phaedra says the soul is enchanted, going to catechumene, by bodily desires and pleasures, he links this experience to the way the mixture of pleasure and pain leads to the illusion that the neutral state of calm is pleasure, a phenomenon that Socrates in Republic Nine calls a kind of enchantment for the time. Second is the way the mixture of pleasure and pain is intense. In citing the role of intense pleasures and pains as the source of the second kind of false belief, Socrates reminds his readers of the way the mixture of pleasure and pain in Republic Nine are phantoms of true pleasures whose juxtaposition makes them appear intense, and in the account of the so-called strongest and most intense pleasures in Philebus. However, when Socrates comes to the illusions associated with pleasure in Phaedra, he does not invoke a mixture with pain to explain the illusion. In fact, he does not explain them at all. Still, the mixture of pleasure and pain has a role to play in our explanation. To see this role, let us now focus on the illusions themselves. The errors associated with pleasure are, one, being enchanted by its desires and pleasures, the soul thinks nothing true but the bodily, what one touches, sees, drinks, eats, and uses for sexual pleasure, and two, it believes, in the face of great or intense pain or pleasure, that about which one is pleased or pained is very distinct and very true. The next paragraph I have rewritten from the text that we have in front of you. We can begin with the account in the Philebus of the way the mixture of pleasure and pain can lead to the intensification of pleasure, which is then mistaken for pure and true pleasure. This mistake explains the illusions of pleasure in the Phaedra. First, let us look at one above. The soul is enchanted by bodily pleasures and desires. If we understand desire to be painful, as it is in Gorgias, then the enchantment is due to a mixture of pain and pleasure. If the soul confuses the intensity of mixed pleasures with pure pleasure, it would think the satisfaction of bodily desire causes pure or true pleasure. If this soul also thinks true pleasure comes from what is itself true, it would think that what satisfies bodily pleasures is true. Thus, we can understand how bodily pleasures enchant the soul into believing that nothing is true but that which serves the satisfaction of bodily desire. That is, the enchanted soul, in turn, the enchanted soul cannot recognize the pleasures associated with knowledge. Lacking knowledge, the soul fails to recognize what is real and true. However, assuming that the philosopher has the pure pleasure associated with knowledge, she will not be enchanted by bodily desire and pleasure in this way. The way the mixture of pleasure and pain leads to illusion also explains, too, the belief in the face of intense pleasure and pain that about which one is pleased or pained is very distinct and very true. That about which one is pleased or pained is pleasing or painful. That about which one is pleased or pained are pleasing or painful situations. As in the Philebus, one is pleased by the prospect of gaining a lot of gold and the accompanying pleasures. The mistake is in thinking that about which one is pleased, gaining a lot of gold, is the clearest and truest. However, the predicates clear and true can be completed by such terms as good and evil, or pleasure and pain. One might mistakenly believe, for instance, that gaining a lot of gold is the clearest and truest good. Equally, one might mistakenly believe gaining a lot of gold is the clearest and truest pleasure. So two implies, with respect to pleasure, the belief in the face of intense pleasure, that that about which one is pleased is a very distinctly pleasurable situation and is a very truly pleasurable situation. The error is in thinking that intense pleasure is pure and true pleasure. The account of the illusions of pleasure explains the falsity of this belief by showing that intense pleasure is not distinct from pain, but in fact is intense because it is mixed with pain. Then, because it is not pure pleasure, it cannot be true pleasure. In turn, the philosopher would not be misled into thinking that great and intense pleasure and pain are very distinct and very true. He would be able to distinguish between intense pleasure, which is mixed, pain, with true pleasure. Now, I'm going to summarize the last sort of paper by saying that the illusion that what follows pleasure, excuse me, what follows pain is pleasure, when it's really the state of calm, also explains another interesting feature of the Phaedo, namely that the soul of the philosopher is going away to what is like itself, namely to the divine. From the Philebus, we have this curious passage that the gods would be lives that are free of pleasure and pain. So the gods then would be without, would presumably be permanently in the state of Hesychia, the state of calm and repose. So what the soul of the philosopher during life is an attempt to minimize pleasure because the philosopher realizes that pleasure leads to calm. However, after death, the philosopher is no longer has to not having a body, no longer has to worry about the emptying of the body and its filling up, and therefore the pleasures and the pains and pleasures associated with that. So after death, the soul of the philosopher achieves this hesychia, this calmness which is associated with the gods, and therefore it makes sense to say that the soul of the philosopher goes away to what is like itself in this particular sense. That is, it is detached from the pains and pleasures of this life.
Thank you very much. Does it work?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the paper, particularly the connection between deceit and pleasure. And the only thing I am afraid I want to ask you is about the last things you said. While I agree that, of course, the philosopher has to come to a disappear state in order to control the silly body with its demands and this and that, I think that the philosopher enjoys the purest, highest pleasure. Right, so he is to attain this as he has said with regard to the bodily pleasures or intense pleasures or mixed pleasures, as you say, or deceitful pleasures. But in his seek for striving for truth and knowledge and ideas and the forms and everything that is singleness to him, he attains the wonderful, best, purest pleasures. Do you agree?
Because I do. I don't want to miss. Since I summarized, I may have overstated my position. The position is that the philosopher escapes the pleasures and pains of the body, and attains. In Philebus, it said that it's unseemly for the gods to experience pleasures and pain. We have to understand that. I think it's unseemly to think of the gods as experiencing the pleasures and pains of the body the way we mortals do. So that's what the philosopher escapes from. But it would be unseemly as well to think the philosopher doesn't have the pleasure of knowledge. Thank you.
Yes, Charles.
the second illusion, where you're taking what is very distinct and very true. Am I correct? You're taking it to be very true pleasures, or very, is that
right?
As opposed to a more metaphysical reading, where it would be like that the body is very real, that sort of thing. Is that correct?
You could phrase that.
Yeah. Okay. So I mean, because I had always read the second illusion, just the problem being that you know you experience these intense pleasures, and then you commit a kind of epistemic slash ontological error where you assume that the body and perceptible things are what is real as opposed to forms, whereas
right.
you're cashing it out in terms of pleasures. You think that these bodily pleasures are true pleasures.
Right.
And I guess, I mean, I'm very attracted to your reading, but one downside of it is it seems to me like the error isn't as bad then. Right? I mean, yes, you're going to leave this like a corporeal pleasure, and that's problematic, but it seems even worse on the other reading where the problem is that you commit this kind of grave philosophical error. And in light of that error, perhaps you're then precluded from gaining knowledge. So I was just wondering what you have to say about that.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. So my understanding is that this is the second error in the Theta, and it's according to my reading, the unknowing person, the non-philosopher, is fooled by the intensity of pleasure, the mixture of pleasure and pain, you think that the pleasure is real pleasure, true pleasure. And then, so this is the step maybe the church I can do. Then this person thinks that what causes the pleasure is true. And then there's another step, being blinded by this. This person feels no need or entered from seeking what's really real. That was my, that was the way my argument went. So and your objective, that first step where you go from true pleasure to caused by true things, or real pleasure to real things.
Sorry, I hear you.
Oh, I'm sorry. So that was sort of my three-step explanation of why these poor people are not interested in intelligible world. So the first step was.
So you're still going to get to the same stopping point, is kind of what you're saying. It's just going to be more steps, is that?
I guess that's it, yeah.
Okay.
True pleasure, so it must be true things.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Which is
it's
kind of what you're doing with the first.
No need for looking for,
so yeah. That's kind of what you're doing with the first illusion, so you're going to use that for the second one as well. Is that?
Yeah, I think so.
Laureato presso l'Università degli Studi di Pisa, nell'anno accademico 99-2000, con il professore Graziano Righetti, discutendo una tesi dal titolo Osservazioni sulla tecnica compositiva del catalogo delle donne di Esione. Poi ha conseguito il titolo di dottore di ricerca presso l'Università degli Studi di Firenze, con una tesi sulla tecnica catalogica di Omero, nell'epoca arcaico, nelle 2003. A partire dal novembre del 2004, è stato borsista sino al 2014 presso il Centro Internazionale per lo Studio dei Papiri e Colonnesi Marcello Giganti. Buono, nell'anno accademico 2014-15 è stato professore al contratto di grammatica greca e filologia classica presso l'Università degli Studi della Tuscia. Attualmente è assegnista di ricerca presso il Dipartimento di Filologia e Letteratura e Linguistica dell'Università degli Studi di Pisa. Passo la parola a Dino De Santis, parla sulla le Socrate nell'arte dei filologi, emozioni e catarsi nel
filologo. Ringrazio la professoressa Pesciotto per le gentili parole della presentazione e colgo anche l'occasione per rivolgere un grazie sincero a Gabriele Cornelli unitamente ai suoi collaboratori per le piacevoli giornate che stiamo trascorrendo a Brasilia nel segno del dialetto e della filologia. Il racconto sulla morte di Socrate che Platone offre nel Fedone, quale ultima tappa del benefico affresco biografico sulla nera Aristos, è affidato alla voce accorta di un narratore sapiente, testimone diretto dell'evento. Sin dalla cornice, la strategia narrativa che domina il dialogo
tematizza con forza il motivo dell'autopsia di Fedone, la visione diretta di uno spettacolo eccezionale, resa possibile grazie alla presenza del narratore nel carcere di Atene. Ececrate di Fiunte, infatti, domanda a Fedone se abbia incontrato Socrate il giorno nel quale bevve la cicuta o se ne abbia sentito parlare da qualcun altro. La risposta affermativa dell'interlocutore, autosso Ececrates, conferma implicitamente, con altrettanta forza, che le parole di Fedone saranno pronunciate nel segno della verità. L'autosso che apre il dialogo in maniera così castica e perentoria, da subito per tutto ciò, si contrappone ad un'eventuale vulgata avvertita come strana, senza autorità, ad una versione che non può essere comprovata. L'autosso che apre il dialogo è la spia inequivocabile che la fiction, che la fiction sulla morte di Socrate, sin dalle prime battute, per il fruitore interno quanto per quello esterno, si propone come un racconto del quale occorre fidarsi senza reggere. Autorità speciale a questo incipit conferisce del resto anche la tradizione poetica, che qui risuona come un'eredità alla quale Platone non rinuncia per dipingere il suo Socrate morente, pur nel riformularne il presupposto. Un significato caso di autopsia, posta sullo stesso piano dell'acqua è il sentito dire, emerge infatti per la prima volta dall'Odissea, quando, per elogiare la perfezione con la quale Demodoco, l'aedo dei Feaci, ha raccontato l'inganno del cavallo, Odissio sottolinea che il canto dell'aedo è stato sviluppato come se Demodoco avesse presenziato l'evento di persona o ne avesse sentito parlare da un altro. Oste pue autos pareon e alia accusas. Delle due possibilità, entrambe valide per l'aedo dei Feaci, essere presente o sentire le parole altrui, Platone evidentemente sceglie la prima come più conforme ed autorevole per il suo Fedone. L'autos che apre il dialogo, l'autos del narratore e spettatore, decisa e voluta strachis, in questo modo finisce per garantire al dialogo il più profondo e sostanziale livello di verità. Non a caso, nel giro di poche parole, prima che la diegesis di Fedone abbia inizio, Ececrate sottolinea che la sua richiesta dipende dal fatto che da ormai molto tempo, da Atene a Fiunte, non sia più giunto nessuno capace di offrire notizie dettagliate sull'ultimo giorno di Socrate. Poche informazioni si concentrano solo intorno all'etale farmaco. Ececrate denuncia così la mancanza di una safenia sulla morte di Socrate, forse non sulle modalità, quanto sul suo significato, tanto da pretendere ora da Fedone un racconto chiaro, sviluppato nel modo più chiaro possibile, safestata, un racconto generoso di particolari che vadano al di là del processo, conosciuto grazie ad un anonimo tiss, nel quale, come ha mostrato ieri Michele Corradi, certo non è difficile riconoscere la voce e il volto di Platone riflessi nelle pagine dell'Apologia. Nella risposta Fedone riprende il motivo del safes, ma subito, dopo il racconto sulla nave di Delo, parentesi cronologica che richiama il Tritone, intreccia il safes al problema della Cribeia, l'esattezza, affermando di nuovo che ricordare Socrate, Top Memnesta e Socratus, attività di certo impegnativa e complessa, è un fatto Edison, offre cioè la forma più compiuta di dolcezza, sia nel caso in cui sia Fedone a parlarne, Caiauton Legonta, sia nel caso in cui Fedone senta al riguardo il racconto di altri, Caiallu Acunta. Al termine del veloce scambio di domande e di risposte, Ececrate ammette che Fedone troverà in lui e nei suoi anonimi amici un gruppo solidale di ascoltatori, una sorta di uditorio selezionato ad un tempo privilegiato, per il quale evidentemente ascoltare il racconto sulla morte di Socrate, condotto nella maniera più perfetta possibile, genererà il più profondo livello di gioia, quel tipo di gioia piena e profonda che già auspica per sé il narratore accingendosi alla sua diegesis. Tra le cornici dei dialoghi di Platone, dunque, quella del Fedone rivela immediatamente la sua complessità a partire da un impegnativo tosse incipitario. Sia nelle intenzioni del narratore, sia nella richiesta di chi lo ascolta, il racconto è presentato come il resoconto personale e veritiero di un evento che innanzitutto deve essere compreso in vista del suo valore eccezionale. La morte di Socrate offre la possibilità di delineare uno spettacolo straordinario, agito e raccontato ad un tempo, già nella cornice, che rivela affinità di fondo, forse non casuali, con l'inizio a scatole cinesi del simposio. Le molte domande poste da Ececrate, gli atti di Socrate, l'identità degli amici intorno a Socrate, le ultime parole del filosofo, rivolte ad un Fedone desideroso di parlare, pongono da subito sulla scena un Socrate dal profilo particolare. Certo il Socrate dell'ultimo giorno, ma anche il Socrate che, circondato dal coro di suoi amici, si mostra benevolo nel riflettere e nel discutere, nonché attivo nella sua speciale natura di nuovo eroe protrettico che va incontro alla morte. È dunque possibile che il racconto sulla morte di Socrate nel Fedone sia concepito come lo spettacolo di una nuova praxis tragica, compiuta da un uomo che agisce e parla, per usare, come vedremo, i termini che definiscono la tragedia nella poetica di Aristotele? È possibile, cioè, che il Fedone si presenti come uno spettacolo osservato di persona dal filo di Socrate e narrato da Fedone a chi è stato assente e quindi all'umanità intera con un fine paradigmatico? È possibile, infine, che Platone concepisca il suo Fedone quale tragedia protrettica volta alla purificazione dei pazzemata, pure incardinata nel codice del dialogo? Per rispondere a tali domande, da dire che, come spesso succede nella produzione di Platone, i motivi che abbiamo individuato nell'incipit, luce a volte fioche, a volte lampanti di una scrupolosa regia, non sono accessori avvenimenti, ma testimoniano in direzione di una lettura, per così dire, drammatica del Fedone. Del resto sono particolari, che sorreggono un'architettura narrativa elaborata, avvolta da una tela fitta di programmatiche anticipazioni e ricca di indicazioni drammaturgiche che sembrano essere vere e proprie didascalie d'autore. Come abbiamo detto, il racconto di Fedone si presenta quale dettagliato resoconto di uno spettacolo eccezionale, perché spettacolo unico per Atene e in fondo anche per il mondo al di fuori di Atene. La fama di quanto accaduto a Socrate, il kleos dell'evento, ha varcato del resto i confini dell'arte che suscita non poco interesse, come peraltro dimostra anche l'interesse appunto di Echecrate. Tale resoconto però finisce per andare al di là della semplice cronaca e assume a poco una prospettiva particolare, volta a richiamare non tanto la modalità della morte, relegata in verità nelle pagine finali, in un attimo veloce con al centro il pietoso gesto di Critone che chiude per sempre gli occhi di Socrate, quanto le parole e gli atti che accompagnano lo scorrere intenso e sublime delle ultime ore del filosofo. Il racconto di Fedone in quest'ottica sembra coincidere con il racconto di un dramma, un insieme di azioni e di parole. Non è un caso, ad esempio, che tra le prime domande di Echecrate nella cornice, Echecrate per l'appunto si mostra interessato innanzitutto a lexenta kai prexenta, le parole dette e le cose fatte da Socrate. Un Socrate che parla e agisce dunque si profila al lettore sulla fine del carcere, e un Socrate che parla e agisce è al centro dell'indagine. A partire da questo momento non pochi saranno gli elementi che richiamano la dimensione teatrale nel Fedone, come spesso con acume la critica ha sottolineato. Da subito, ad esempio, e lo ricordo solo incidentalmente, premiante valore drammatico assume il coro di amici intorno a Socrate, voci attonite, solidali, vicine alla nera, destinate ad essere salvate come i disertà ateniesi salvati da Teseo. L'errore nel quale Platone suggerisce di scorgere, tramite una sorta di interpretazione figurale ante litteram, l'antecedente di Socrate soterra. È sempre il rapporto all'atmosfera drammatica che pervade il dialogo, e da ricordare che dinanzi ad Echecrate, Fedone sottolinea che l'ultimo giorno di Socrate ha garantito a chi è stato presente all'evento lo spettacolo di cose mirabili, di impatto straordinario, una serie di zaumazia provati nell'animo di Fedone e condivisi da tutti. Vorrei osservare nel dettaglio appunto questa sezione 58e 59b. Il modo in cui Socrate si prepara alla morte è di per sé singolare, come ricorda Fedone, visto che il condannato non rivela timore o ritrosia, ma si presenta ai filori in una condizione di nobile e intrepida serenità, quale modello perfetto di Eudaimon sia nel tropos sia nell'ovoli. Ne deriva una reazione particolare da parte di chi assiste alla scena. Non nasce Helios, immediata e comprensibile pietà, come sarebbe naturale dinanzi al Pentos, né si sviluppa Edonè, consueta gioia già provata nelle precedenti discussioni che aprono una finestra sugli incontri, ormai passati, lungo i portici e ginnasi di Atene. Fedone nota che l'atteggiamento di Socrate nel suo ultimo giorno di vita ha creato un ato con pathos in chi lo ha assistito, una sensazione insolita, difficile da definire con esattezza, ma fondamentale per comprendere la prospettiva paradigmatica che regola il dialogo. Osservare le ultime ore di Socrate genera nell'animo degli amici riuniti nel carcere un'insolita commistione di piacere e di dolore, una eces crazis, che codifica e fissa i confini di questo atto con pazzos e accomuna sul piano emotivo il gruppo di uomini raccolto intorno a Socrate. La stranezza del sentimento ricordato da Fedone e dagli amici si pone in netto contrasto rispetto alla serenità di Socrate. Non a caso deriva da questo gioco di opposizioni caratteriali un saldo intreccio di d'acqua e d'eros, lacrime e risa, che connota lo stato d'animo di tutti i figli. Da questo momento nel Fedone, Platone tende con particolare insistenza a segnalare le reazioni dei suoi protagonisti, come se d'acqua e d'eros, lacrime e risa, diventassero le principali direttrici narrative nella trama generale del racconto e ne segnassero gli snodi decisivi. Tale prospettiva non desta meraviglia, anche attraverso lo sviluppo di queste reazioni e la loro progressiva purificazione dinanzi alla morte di Socrate, è possibile seguire il percorso che rende il Fedone una tragedia nuova. Innanzitutto nel Fedone è dato spazio al categorico rifiuto della reazione smodata, permeata di sterile pianto, di dolore scomposto e plateale, di lutto eccessivo, in vista di una precisa misura delle emozioni. Non è motivato ad esempio che da subito sia fatta menzione della reazione di Apollodoro, che piange copiosamente, distinguendosi di Aferontos rispetto agli altri filoi. Apollodoro tuttavia può restare al cospetto di Socrate, come se rappresentasse il livello meno perfetto ma perfettibile della corretta reazione emotiva da adottare dinanzi a questo spettacolo. Il comportamento da rifiutare con ferma decisione invece vede schiava Santippe, congedata dal carcere, mentre tra lamenti e lacrime lacera vesti, urla, ripete le solite cose che dicono le donne. Le parole che Fedone rivolge alle Echecrate, tu sai com'è fatta, non è vero, già formulate per il pianto di Apollodoro, in realtà sembrano essere rivolte al lettore del Fedone, con un livello di consapevole autorealità di Platone che per così dire ora strizza l'occhio al suo lettore. E questo è un primo e fondamentale momento nel quale Platone ci introduce di persona nella ricezione del suo dramma speciale, attraverso una speciale esclusione. Nel particolareggiato ritratto sulle scomposte reazioni emotive di Santippe, che viene allontanata dal carcere, interessata alla disperazione vana più che al logos salutare e salvifico, è possibile cogliere la codificazione letteraria di una teoria sulla quale Platone torna a riflettere anche nella Repubblica, quando appare categorico il rifiuto della mimesis di donne che urlano e inorgogliscono contro uomini e dei, di donne che appaiono punte dalle vaghezze dell'amore, di donne colte dalle doglie che si lasciano irretire dalla mossa del dolore e del lutto. Tale dettagliato campionario di profili e di comportamenti umani di intenso e fallace patetismo richiamato nella Repubblica. Un campionario che la tragedia, soprattutto la tragedia di Ovidio, con l'amante Fedra, la vanagloriosa Niobe, la disperata Medea, ha ufficializzato sulla scena di Atene. Nel realizzare il nuovo dramma nel segno di Socrate, nel Fedone invece Platone suggerisce la necessità di stabilire una frizione matura del difficile spettacolo, una frizione che esuli da comportamenti sfrenati e inconciliabili con la natura esemplare del suo protagonista. Santippe, che il lettore conosce, perché forse ha già visto sulla scena tragica il suo modo di comportarsi, riflesso nella natura agitata di patetiche eroine, finisce per rappresentare il livello negativo da rifiutare nella ricezione auspicabile del dramma proposta in filigrana nel dialogo, visto che rischia di invalidare il beneficio che per l'appunto da questo dramma può derivare. Il categorico apagetotis autem oikade che Socrate ingiunge a Critone ristabilisce nel carcere di Atene la possibilità di una ricezione salutare positiva, mentre esclude per sempre Dezza Amasia, lo spettacolo meraviglioso e straordinario, lo sguardo esagitato e in verità immaturo di Santippe. Al di là del pianto di Santippe, anche gli amici di Socrate, da subito, come ho detto, sono colti dalle lacrime, ma si ha l'impressione che questi d'acqua assumano nel dialogo via via una sfumatura diversa rispetto a quella che abbiamo osservato all'inizio del Fedone, quando il pianto dei filoi nasce dalla supposizione che Socrate, andando incontro alla morte, stia soffrendo. I d'acqua della sera, quando tramonta il sole ad Atene, sono di natura opposta a quelli che solcano il viso dei filoi al mattino, quando si stende sulla città un'alba luttuosa. Giunto il bel momento fatale di bere la cicuta, i discepoli cercano di trattenere le lacrime, ma alla fine non riescono ad opporsi ad un'emozione tanto forte. più consapevole e pensosa però rispetto alla prima scena e ora la prospettiva di Dracula. I Filoi capiscono che Socrate morendo li lascerà orfani per il resto della vita, senza un padre, senza una guida, a meno che non continuino a perseverare con coraggio sulla strada luminosa della filosofia. Bevuta la cicuta del resto, mentre Apollodoro è ancora in preda alle lacrime, secondo un'accuratissima ricomposizione, Fedone, che ha cercato di nascondere il suo pianto, non riesce a trattenere la sua commozione. Si tratta del momento decisivo ed improvviso della comprensione. Ora Fedone capisce finalmente di dover piangere solo per se stesso e per la sua sventurata chiude e non più per un destino che in verità Socrate ha accettato da subito. La parola di Socrate, tramite un rimprovero necessario rivolto ai suoi amici zaumasoi, uomini dallo strano comportamento, ristabilisce ora il corretto ordine emotivo da seguire nel segno di una riflessiva vergogna che al termine del dialogo prende il coro degli amici intorno al Philosophos. Socrate ammonisce i suoi figli, spiegando la necessità di raggiungere la esuchia e di mantenere un comportamento carterosso. Le lacrime finali del Fedone, dunque, si pongono nel dialogo quale testimonianza concreta di una consapevolezza dell'errore che all'inizio del dialogo, per l'appunto, i figli hanno commesso nel piangere l'imminente morte del filosofo. Del resto, una prova decisiva del nuovo pianto che si fa strada via via nel dialogo è offerta, a mio avviso, durante la scena del messo mandato dagli undici. Si tratta di un uomo che non da molto tempo è accanto a Socrate, un uomo definito da Socrate ottimo amico, capace di piangere Gennaios nobilmente, un uomo che non può rimproverare nulla a Socrate visto la natura eccezionale di questo condannato, un uomo dunque che non riesce a trattenere le lacrime pensando alla morte di colui che ai suoi occhi appare come più gentile, il più mite, l'uomo migliore tra tutti coloro che hanno dimorato nelle celle del carcere di Atene. Non è forse errato pensare che questo messo in fondo rappresenti la prospettiva del lettore, di chi pur da poco venuto a contatto con Socrate ne ha compreso la decisiva importanza grazie alle sue parole e al suo continuo dialogo con lui. Non è un caso dunque che il congedo del messo degli undici si è sviluppato ancora nel segno di un pianto dirotto che a differenza di quello di Santippe, Socrate alla fine della sua vita accetta e osserva con serenità. Il commiato che Socrate rivolge al messo, il sommesso caire, sembra essere il congedo che Platone fa rivolgere da parte di Socrate al lettore del Fedone, che sinora ha frequentato Socrate e ha intrattenuto con lui un benefico dialetestai, imparandone la necessaria utilità. Si ha l'impressione che tramite la reazione dei Filoi di Socrate negli ultimi attimi della sua vita, Platone intenda suggerire al lettore una corretta visione del reale, modellata non a caso sull'uomo esemplare per eccellenza. Socrate riesce a guidare verso l'agaton l'umanità purificandola con la sua nobile serenità e con le sue giovevoli parole. Del resto, nel Fedone, mentre Socrate è chiamato a seguire il destino assegnatogli, come direbbe una nerta di Cos, il campo semantico della catarsis è sintomatico e decisivo, più che in ogni altro dialogo, come se Platone avesse l'intenzione di segnalarne la specifica centralità. La grande lezione che Aristotele offre nella poetica, nel momento in cui definisce la tragedia quale mimesi di un'azione nobile che arriva alla catarsi dei patemata attraverso Helios e Phobos, ha in questo modo le sue premesse nella vicenda universale della morte di Socrate. Non sorprende che nel Fedone anche il processo di catarsi sia teorizzato in una prospettiva paradigmatica e protrettica di un tempo. Socrate innanzitutto spiega che il processo di separazione dell'anima dal corpo, altro non essere una purificazione, una catarsis per l'appunto, dalla dissennatezza del soma, al fine di conquistare la verità. Ma non solo. Nello sviluppare questo ragionamento, Socrate arriva a rifiutare anche lo scambio dei piaceri coi piaceri, dei timori coi timori, dei dolori con i dolori, per raggiungere la vera virtù. La moneta corretta per uno scambio corretto è la phronesis, tramite la quale si ottiene il coraggio, la temperanza, la giustizia, un sistema etico inteso come supremo strumento in grado di portare a compimento la catarsis, la purificazione dei falsi piaceri, dei timori e dei dolori. In questo modo è possibile comprendere, nel finale del dialogo, il profilo esemplare di Socrate Aristos, eroe phronimotatos e di Caiotatos, il compagno migliore del quale Fedone, i suoi amici, e l'umanità tutta hanno potuto avere un'esperienza sostanziale in quanto esperienza intellettuale in chiave etica. Apprendere e praticare la phronesis e la dica di Socrate, Aristos Aner, purifica l'uomo che è davvero vicino al Philosophos e per questo è destinato a beneficiare per sempre di una guida che mai lo lascerà orfano. Grazie dell'attenzione.
Posso parlare spagnolo? No, lo mio è solamente un commentario generale, non è una domanda puntuale, però mi gustaría saber tu reazione. Me parece importante recordar, come tu ricordas qui, esos passaggi dove Platón presenta la situazione della morte di Sócrates, rodeado por sus amigos, en eso parecido a lo que en español llamamos sentimientos encontrados, ¿no? Mixed feelings, ¿no? Eso que es tan difícil de explicar, ¿no? O sea, pero lo que me parece más interesante y me gustaría saber tu reflexión es el hecho de que Platón en el Fedón, por lo menos dos veces, dice que la phronesis es un pathema. Seguramente pathema ahí no puede ser entendido en el sentido de un sentimiento, ¿no? O de una emoción, no sé, me parece, pero me gustaría saber tu reacción a ese comentario. Gracias
por questa domanda. Io sì, è un pathema, ma naturalmente è qualcosa che si prova fortemente. Io credo anche che si possa appunto provare nell'intimità della persona, dell'essere umano, quindi effettivamente nel momento in cui Platone sottolinea la valenza, una delle possibili valenze della phronesis nell'ambito dell'umanità, nell'ambito di un uomo, e la sottolinea come parte, ma forse credo appunto voglia mettere in evidenza in questo caso la possibilità di l'aspetto, diciamo, del sentimento della phronesis, credo che appunto possa essere inteso in questo modo, se ho capito. E quindi è una condivisione, in questo caso la phronesis porterebbe ulteriormente a condividere i veri patemata che appunto vanno provati e quelli che invece vanno rifiutati, in fondo. Potrebbe essere un'ulteriore spiegazione.
No, claro, lo mio iba por el lado de decir que cuando Platón dice que la phronesis es un pathema, mi impresión, ¿no?
Sí,
eso
sí.
Puede discutir. Es que ahí pathema no puede querer decir algo parecido a un estado emocional, ¿no? Sino a la condición o estado en el que se encuentra en el alma de quien tiene phronesis. ¿No?
Penso di sí, sí, al menos a mí se così, sí, sí, sí.
Ciao.
Ciao.
Bom dia, eu gostaria de saber se eu poderia perguntar em português, você traduzir para o italiano, Miriam.
Grazie.
Sim. Bom dia, obrigado, foi uma excelente comunicação. Eu fiquei pensando quando você falou de tragédia, você acentuou aspectos da tragédia na sua leitura, você chega a falar de tragédia nova, e, né, o espetáculo maravilhoso e extraordinário da morte de Sócrates, de tudo aquilo que ela enseja, mas você falou de átopon também, átopon pathos. E o átopon pathos é um sentimento de alguma maneira contraditório também. Então, a questão assim, em outras passagens de diálogos, por exemplo, em Filebo, ele fala também do átopo na tragédia e na comédia. Toda a vida humana é misturada com prazeres e dores, né? Essa mistura de prazeres e dores é uma mistura átopo, né? Em Filebo e no banquete, também Alcibíades descreve o Sócrates átopo, e ele fala de um drama satírico, uma mistura de alguma maneira entre tragédia e comédia. Minha pergunta é, você falou das lágrimas dos amigos, mas não poderíamos também pensar nos risos, nas gargalhadas dos amigos no Fedon? Se isso não seria um, né? Obrigado.
Giorgio, grazie mille per questa domanda che mi dà, io rispondo in italiano, che mi dà appunto la possibilità di parlare dell'altra parte che ho dovuto necessariamente mettere appunto, accantonare, è appunto il riso, il gelos. il Gelos che effettivamente è presente in tutto il dialogo parallelamente al piano, che è presente sia per gli amici di Socrate, sia per Socrate stesso, che appunto ride quando risponde ai suoi compagni. È vero che il riso e il riso e il pianto possono essere, anzi devono essere posti nel Fedone sullo stesso piano proprio in relazione all'ato con pathos, perché credo effettivamente che l'ato con pathos del quale gli amici Fedoni, gli amici di Socrate si sentono catturati, per così dire, altro non sia che la chiave interpretativa del nuovo genere letterario che Platone con il Fedone inaugura, una tragedia nella quale inevitabilmente deve essere, come si diceva appunto anche ieri, grazie ad una Kreuzung, Vergattung, ad una commissione dei generi, deve per forza confluire la commedia. La commedia a poco poi viene, gli aspetti comici vengono poi a poco abbandonati, pur anche se rimane il riso di Socrate è un riso calmo, sereno, non un riso scomposto, è un riso pensoso, potremmo dire, per arrivare poi al culmine della nuova tragedia, che appunto al culmine, la parte fondamentale della nuova tragedia. Credo che sia, io naturalmente mi sono soffermato sulle lacrime, sul pianto, sull'emozione forse più plateale, ma effettivamente come hai sottolineato con Acume, appunto il riso è fondamentale tanto quanto il pianto. In fondo gli elementi comici di questo dialogo sono forti, come gli elementi comici sono forti in Platone, personaggi come Santippe, che effettivamente può essere letta in un'ottica tragica, almeno alla luce della Repubblica, è un personaggio di per sé che assume, ha degli aspetti della Graus in commedia. Il Ciro Rosso, il portiere, è un elemento comico al quale Platone ricorre nel Protagora, un elemento ripreso da Aristofane, per esempio. Io penso ad esempio alle nuvole, al discepolo di Socrate che fa da Ciro Rosso, da portiere contro Filippide e Strepsiade. Sono tutti elementi comici che Platone, proprio per creare una nuova poesia, la poesia appunto del Fedone e la poesia del dialogo, appunto, riprende.
Puedo hablar español también, ¿no? Mejor. Esto no sé si va así. Muchísimas gracias, porque me ha encantado la forma y el contenido, las dos cosas, ¿no? Indudablemente bellísima la manera de expresar. Y me llama la atención esta clasificación de lágrimas, ¿no? Porque está la lágrima de Xantippa, que es rechazada, ¿no? Luego está la lágrima de Apolodoro, que es susceptible de educación, y luego está la lágrima del portero, que tú marcas este llorar gedaios, ¿no? Que, como dices bien, Sócrates acepta, ¿no? Entonces, esta clasificación la encuentro muy útil, porque uno puede tender a solo quedarse con la lágrima de Xantippa o de Apolodoro o de Fedón o cuando él los reta, ¿no? los obliga a ser valientes y no pensar en sí mismos, sino en seguir la filosofía que es la salvación y, como diciendo, les he dado la llave de la salvación, no hay para llorar, no. Pero esta clasificación incluye esta aceptación de lágrimas nobles, ¿no? Genuina. ¿Podría decir algo más sobre esto o no?
Scusa, sì, grazie, anche questa domanda mi dà la possibilità di soffermarmi un po' forse più nel dettaglio su un argomento al quale peraltro sono molto legato e che mi dà la possibilità anche di parlare brevemente, naturalmente, del problema del pianto ripreso da Platone, un problema che peraltro ha nell'ambito della poetica greca, della poetica arcaica, assume una posizione fondamentale a partire da Omero. Io penso appunto che il pianto dell'eroe, di fronte ad un fatto, soprattutto di fronte alla poesia, se pensiamo a Demodoco che canta e fa piangere Odisseo, perché appunto far ricordare, far capire ad Odisseo la sua vita, in fondo, raccontandogli la caduta di Troia. Pensiamo al pianto, ad esempio, al maturo pianto di fronte, sempre alla sorte di Odisseo nel quarto dell'Odissea, quando il pianto prende tutto il pubblico alla corte di Menelao. Il pianto del Fedone, io credo sia appunto recuperato e rivisto, rivisitato poi da Platone, proprio da questa tradizione, che rende il pianto non un semplice pathos, ma rende il pianto come, rende la poetica del pianto come una prova della consapevolezza da parte di chi piange nei confronti di ciò che sta vivendo. E in fondo il pianto Vennalius, il pianto condotto Vennalius nobilmente da parte del messo mandato dagli undici, è una, soprattutto nel Vennalius, nell'avverbio Vennalius, non è altro che una ripresa in fondo di un aspetto del carattere di Socrate, che proprio all'inizio del Fedone in fondo muore Vennalius, si presenta a morire nobilmente. Quindi credo che in fondo, se è vero, se è possibile pensare che appunto nel messo ci sia un aspetto anche del lettore di Socrate, del lettore di Platone, forse anche il Platone ha capito qualcosa da Socrate, riproducendo un aspetto positivo appunto di Socrate, del carattere di Socrate, della sua indole, della sua grandezza. Ecco perché il valore protettico credo che sia fortissimo nel Fedone, sia appunto la chiave centrale di lettura di questo piano.
Sì, per questa mirada di Aristotele, no?
Certo.
Che desideri che la nuova tragedia educativa. Muy bien.
And the last question.
Allora, grazie Dino per questa bella relazione nella quale tu hai ricostruito l'atteggiamento di tutti i personaggi che sono lì alla morte di Socrate. Mi è molto piaciuto come hai ricostruito Santippe, esempio al negativo, e poi Fedone che ha un diverso atteggiamento all'inizio e alla fine, e poi Apollodoro, e poi addirittura il messo degli undici. Hai avuto attenzione per il significato di questi personaggi. Ti volevo allora chiedere: qual è secondo te il significato dell'assenza di Platone a questo scenario? Platone che non c'era, perché era malato.
Grazie Lilia, grazie mille, grazie. Io credo che sia appunto che l'assenza di Platone ci dia la possibilità di poter parlare di questi caratteri, perché Platone, allontanandosi dal dialogo volutamente rispetto all'apologia, per esempio, la quale Platone invece c'è, no? Prende le distanze da narratore rispetto a quello che deve essere una fiction, che deve essere appunto il racconto, e prendendo queste distanze non fa altro che, per tornare ad Aristotele, rendere universale e quindi il più possibile poetico, nel modo più possibile poetico, il racconto del Fedone, proprio perché il racconto del Fedone, che a noi sembra qualcosa di particolare, sembra appunto veramente che cosa, per usare sempre il parola della poetica, cosa sia successo a Socrate, che cosa abbia patito Socrate, in realtà assume, proprio grazie a questa esclusione di Platone dal momento, assume una prospettiva universale. Del resto nel simposio, io appunto, e anche Apollodoro in fondo è un legame ulteriore con il simposio, del resto nel simposio, con questo allontanarsi graduale da un punto di vista narrativo, grazie alla cornice, ad un gioco narrativo profondo di cornice nella cornice, di racconto nel racconto, Platone prende le distanze, ma non per scomparire, per dare appunto la possibilità di comprendere quello e di raccontare appunto quello che è successo. Credo appunto che questa possa essere un'interpretazione di questa voluta assenza, segnalata assenza di Platone.